Well, hello, boys and girls. I'm Pearl of Wisdom, and you're listening to my NHL Pearls of Wisdom. And today, I'm going to be assessing each team's free agents, at least seven of them anyways. I'll be doing several videos like this. And this is all one take. Give it a fly. I'm going to give them a rating so far for this after the free agent. Were you there? Were you part of that yesterday? I did like a marathon live show on NHL Pearls of Wisdom yesterday. That's my show that I do, which I'm doing tonight from 5:30 to 7:30 Mountain or 7:30 to 9:30 Eastern. Come join. Tell me about what you think about the tonight, by the way, is today is, just in case you don't know when it is, Thursday 29th. For Friday, I'll be doing it during the day from 3:30 to 5:30. It's so much fun. Frolic, interaction. We had so many people there. You'll love it. I'll do a little Perlo dancing. Anyways, if you want to hear some funny stuff, wait till the end of the video and we talk about some things that are coming up in the future for Pearls of Wisdom, the Pearl of Wisdom show, and me in itself. And Steel Flyers All Sports Network, also the company that I am part of, community. If you're looking to be a guy who does kind of what I'm doing and get paid a little bit of money for it, tell me in the comment section. We're looking for creators for football, basketball, baseball, and hockey. All four sports, all teams talked about. Any team you want to do, or all the teams, however you want to do it. If you know a lot about the sport, you want to do something like this, maybe writing is more up your alley, blogging. We need those too, so let us know and go over there. Okay, I'm so excited. Let's go. Free agent time is like my favorite time in the land. I freaking love it. Love it. Love it. Let's take a look at some of the teams. We'll start from Anaheim, okay? My grade for Anaheim, I mean, what do you give for Anaheim? They did better show it. There we go. Anaheim, Ryan Getzlaf, $4.5 million. Like, who cares? Seriously, just so he retires there. You know, good for him. He chooses not to win a cup. He chooses to retire in Anaheim. That's his prerogative. That's what he wants to do. That's fine. Nice little pickup of Brogan Rafferty, though, for 1 year, $750K. Picked him up from Vancouver. He probably will be able to fill some minutes for them. But on a whole, they didn't do anything. Now, you say, okay, what am I giving them for a ranking here? I'm actually going to give them a C because this was probably not the time to sign free agents. For the rest of this year, a lot of these teams that bought free agents are up to the cap and are going to need to lose some players. So they could probably pluck off some pretty cheap players out there. I think I'm giving them a C for now until I see who they pluck off the roster. I almost want to give them a higher rating because it was a really smart idea to just stay out of this free agent business. They keep Getzlaf, which is a good story. And the problem with, of course, with Anaheim is where are they going? I don't know if they're rebuilding or not rebuilding. Let's look at their roster. Okay, Isaac Lundstrom put up 9 points in 41 games. Really good defensive forward. But, I mean, he's at this point, he's your first or second left wing. Actually, you can't even tell. Maxim Comtois could be. Max Jones could break out finally at 23 years old and be that top line left winger. But honestly, there's nobody here that screams they're going to be the top line left winger. So they're still in a very transitional period. Rickard Rakell needs to be re-signed after next year. The most exciting part of this lineup to me is Trevor Zegras, of course. How is he going to produce as a 21-year-old in the league last year in what looks like will be his first full season? I'm hoping that they're not playing this guy too young like other teams I won't mention, other Sabres I won't mention, or something of that nature. And the Edmonton Oilers did it. There's been a few teams that have played guys too young. It might have happened with Sam Steele here too. But overall, this team is just rolling with what they got and really crossing their fingers. The thing that I have a problem with is, and this could change over the summer too, is they have guys like Manson, Fowler, and Lindholm, on a lesser extent, Jacob Larson, that probably could get some pretty good return out there right now. Having them stagnate until this team is good, I don't know if that's the right move. Tell me what you think down there, Anaheim Ducks fans. You think they should trade these guys off and really just do a rebuild, or keep them for veteran leadership for the young guys that they may be bringing along? The big one for me, though, too, is John Gibson. John Gibson has not looked happy for a while there in Anaheim, and I don't blame him. He's 28 years old. His career is going by pretty quickly here. And if I'm a player and I'm looking at the Anaheim Ducks, this team doesn't look like it's going to be really competitive for a while now. I think they got a lot of big decisions here on what they're going to do. If they're going to hold on to these guys, I don't know if it's going to be a very good effect in the team in the long run. I guess it depends on if they're happy to be able to just build this and be hopefully contenders by the time they're 33 years old, 32 years old. It doesn't look like, from what I've seen on the ice and some of the things I've heard, that John Gibson is one of those guys. So very difficult to move him, but I really think that they have to look at doing something like that. For young players coming up, they just picked Mason McTavish, which rocks. I think that was a good pickup, but he's going to be a few years away. Sam Colangelo, it looks like he's going to be a getter. I'm not sure about Pustyov. Sorry if I got that name wrong. I haven't delved too deep into their prospect pool as of late. But Olin Zellweger was a nice pickup, but nothing really screams ready here. That's why I really think it would be a good idea for them to let their veterans go, bring in some different veterans that are maybe even older and just satisfied with being on a team and having a role as a pioneer for the future of what Anaheim may be. However, maybe Manson and those guys are that. Maybe that's what they want to do. I don't know. If I was them, I wouldn't. Alexander Volkov, I really, really like. That's my surprise player of this year. I want to see how he does this year. Okay, let's go to our next one then. The Arizona Coyote. I'm going to skip Arizona for now. Sorry, I don't have Arizona up here. The Boston Bruins. Sorry, I'll do Arizona later. Boston Bruins. I loved what they did here. My rating for them for what the pickups that they did right now is a B plus, somewhere around there. Maybe even close to an A. It depends on what they do finish off in the summer. But with that in mind, maybe I'll even give them an A. Nick Foligno, 2 years, $3.8 million. I didn't see that coming. I didn't see that coming at all. I thought he was going to Minnesota for sure. The question here is, and we'll see when we look at their cap space, are they going to be able to sign Krejci now? If not, I'm not sure if I like it as much as I thought. Foligno is an excellent two-way player, but his offense has been dwindling for a while. I don't know how comfortable I am playing him now as a second-line center. They're not paying him as a second-line center, $3.8 million. And Hall and Krejci had a lot of chemistry. Foligno, I don't know if he's going to be able to keep up with Hall, to tell you the honest truth, if they're planning on playing him as a second line center there. So that would be my, the reason why I don't give him really an A as of yet. But then they picked up Eric Halla, excellent 3-4 guy, third line, fourth line guy who can do just about everything. He plays all over. He plays center, he plays wing, great utility player. I thought that was an excellent signing for where they're going. Boston is looking to win now, and picking up players like that is certainly going to help them. Same as Thomas Noshik. He's more of a center, but in this on this team, he's probably a little bit on the expensive side for a fourth line center. But I love his size, and he can play higher if there's injuries. He can find his way with his big body and driving to the net to create a little bit of offense, actually. He showed it in Vegas, not too bad. At the very least, he opens up a lot of space for his line mates. I like these signings because they can play fourth and they can play third if there's injuries. So this really covers up any injury issues that they may have. Derek Forbert, really nice move. Derek Forbert has been growing into a solid defensive defenseman. On this team, he's probably going to be in a 5-6 role, which is an excellent role for him at $3 million a year. I think he can play at a 3-4 with the right mix, but I think the best role for him is a 5-6, but he's very good at it. I would put him at almost the same level as an Edmondson in Montreal. He's really built himself up extremely well through his career. Hard worker, great attitude, solid physical guy. And we know how much Boston loves those guys, right? Linus Allmark, $5 million, 4 years. They're getting a lot of flack for this. I was saying earlier that Rask was probably on his way out. And I would say now that it's almost assured that he is on his way out. I didn't think he was on his way out in the sense that he was going anywhere, though. I think he might retire. And I think they know that it's likely that he's going to retire. So Linus Allmark at $5 million. I was talking to some Buffalo Sabres fans that they thought this was too much for Allmark. And I get their point because he hasn't really proven it yet. But sometimes you got to go on projection on how talented a player really looks. When Allmark was in net, Buffalo had a chance. He hasn't put up great numbers, as you know, for a number one goaltender. But 0.917 ain't bad for 20 games. 34 games, he had 269 and a 9.15. For a Buffalo team that was like worse than the league or close to it, I'd say those are pretty darn good numbers. I think playing in front of Boston's defense is going to look he's going to look really good. I think you're going to be really excited about the signing. It's unfortunate. I think Rask is, though, probably on his way out. So let's look at the depth chart a little bit and see how it looks after all the moves that they made. Marchand, Bergeron, Pasternak. They have Charlie Coyle as a second-line center here. Like I said, that's something that can't be. Oh, we didn't look at – I forgot – anyways, I know their cap space. Their cap space is $1 million. So that's the issue here. I know they're looking to trade Jake DeBrus. They might have something in their back pocket there for Jake DeBrus to move out. If he does, though, that's where some of these guys on the lower end come in, like Eric Halla will come up and play in that spot. And he can play on the third line. They have Noshik as a third line center here. So it looks like they're going to give him a role at third line center. And I think he could probably do it with Foligno. If they put Foligno on the right side on that line, that is one line I wouldn't want to come across too often, man. That is a solid, thick, big line that is not afraid to bring the physicality for sure. So, in all, I think it was a very good move. I just want to see Krejci here. And then you can bring Charlie Coyle down here and then Noshik down here. And that's probably the more comfortable spot for him. And then they have some young players. Jack Studnicka is probably ready, I would think, to play in there. Bleed has been a good soldier for a long time. Why not play him on the fourth line? I always think he looks fine in that role. Maybe Zach Zanishin, but their depth is actually not too bad. And as far as their defense is concerned, after getting Forbert, and signing Mike Riley, I forgot about that. Nice move that they traded for from Ottawa the year before. Moves the puck well. Really, this defense is much better with Forbert in that lineup. Even though they lost Lazan, I like Forbert a lot better. He's much more mature. And Riley is pretty solid. Depth might be a little bit of a problem, though. Jacob Saburo got a little bit of a cup of coffee last year. John Moore probably will never play again. And then they're grooming Vaakanainen will probably get a little bit of work up there. I guess like with any team though, if they run into some a rash of injuries on their defense, it's going to be tough. But I think you can say that for most teams out there. I'm really excited to see what Linus Ullmark does here, but I think Boston did a really good job of making them still a contender as they move forward with their older players. The Buffalo Sabres. Buffalo Sabres picking up Anderson, that was just an emergency move in case they can't find another goaltender, honestly. He's 40 years old. Man, 79, he's almost like a goalie coach at this point. I'm pretty sure they're going to have to find another goaltender. Vinny Hinostroza, 1 year, 1.5 million. He fills in some offense. They're just filling in pieces this year because they're really rebuilding. And we'll see when we look at their depth chart where exactly they are. That's why goaltending is going to be needed. I mean, when you're rebuilding, you do need a good goaltender, but it's okay to search for one for a while you're going to suck anyways. I'm sorry about Buffalo. I'm pretty sure you already know you're going to suck still some more. They picked up Aaron Dell for 750K. He's never been able to make it in the NHL for very long. So I did like Mark Pishak. Mark Pishak will be happy to be in Buffalo, get his 1 year contract. He can play in a 5-6 role. He did so in Florida. He did pretty good in Dallas, and he can play as a forward fairly well. I actually think he might be a better forward than he is a defenseman. So let's look at their depth chart. First, we want to look at their cap room, which is crazy. They got a ton of cap room. And this is another one where 30 million cap space and they haven't traded Eichel. I didn't even mention Eichel yet. Stuff on the table for Eichel. Everybody's not happy with their asking right now. And I said when I was doing my Eichel videos that I doubted very much that he was going to be traded until much closer to his surgery return and all that kind of stuff like that. People are going to need to get information, as much information as they can. Apparently, Buffalo hasn't been all that forward with the information, which is going to cause a problem for bringing in a lot of much of a package for him. So, taking Eichel, they would even have to get to the cap floor. But like I was talking about with Anaheim, they have an opportunity here now to pick off people's rosters and get some very good deals. Maybe even get picks to take players to get to the cap floor and keep on improving as a team. So I think that's likely what they're doing. So they I good that they good that they did it the way they did. Now we know they traded Reinhardt. I talked about that. You can look at my video that I did. And of course they traded Ritsalainen. You can look at the video I did of that as well. I talk about that, but as a whole, I think they did pretty good in a return on that. They're going to have now a couple more first round draft picks and some young. It's going to be a young team. So Jack Eichel's injured. You take him out of the mix. Casey Mittelstadt. I really he was looking really good in the second half last year. Watch out for him up in that first C spot next year with Granato giving him all the confidence in the world. He has so much talent. He was picked 8th overall. I can't remember what year now. I want to say 2015, 16, something like that. Why should I look at it really quick? 17, sorry, 2017. And he hasn't really reached it, but neither has anybody in Buffalo. But the second half of last year, guys like Casey Mittelstadt, Tage Thompson, started looking a lot better and putting points up on the board. I'm actually kind of excited to see if this young group can do a little more damage than people think next year. Hopefully Jeff Skinner can get whatever. I don't know what. I don't know. That would be huge for them if Jeff Skinner could even be a 50-point player. Gosh. Anders Bjork, which they got for Hall, will give it her another shot. Dylan Cousins, 6'3", 183, man. And he's probably going to be bigger. That could end up being a very good, he could end up being a very good center in the league. I just, again, I'm a little concerned about rushing him into the league now, especially as a center. But if he can handle it, I think that he projects to be a big 50-point guy or more, which is huge. It's huge. 50-point big centerman, 6'3" centerman. Look around the league. They're hard to find, man. So they're not what migrating for their free agency, almost like Anaheim. They kind of kept it down. They didn't. I think you're going to see them do a lot more with their cap space to add some players as the summer goes along. So I think it was smart. I'm going to give them a C because they really didn't do much, but maybe shouldn't. Oh, you know what? I forgot about Will Butcher. Ouch. That's not going to be fun to watch, boys and girls. Not a bad defenseman to have if you're not big on winning. They do got to sign Rasmus Dahlin, though, and I think it would be a really good idea. This would be a smart move to take a gamble because Rasmus Dahlin has been brought up very poorly, and yes, his defense has not been very good, but it should be. He's got all the talent in the world. I would see if you could sign the guy for $5 million for 8 years. And see if he would bite on it. Because with the proper development, that maybe with Granato and their new team, this guy is a 1-2 defenseman. Just imagine if you had a 1-2 defenseman making $5 million a year 4 years from now. Woo! Pretty darn good, man. As far as the goaltenders, like I said, they're going to have to pick up a goaltender somewhere. I don't know exactly where that's going to be. And they still got Ristolainen, who was crushing it in the second half up there. I think he'll find a spot on here somewhere. And Matthias Samuelsson was playing really well, although they may have given him a look and they're going to groom him in the minors a little bit, but I like him a lot. So there's a lot more on Buffalo to look forward to than people think, I think. Next team, Calgary Flames. My rating for them is, like, again, probably a C. C minus. I love Blake Coleman, and unlike a lot of people, I don't mind the $5 million a year contract for what he does. I mean, the guy put up some pretty nice points in Tampa Bay, not playing very high in the lineup, 31 points in 55 games. He's done that similar. He did it in New Jersey. Also, you know, they're going to play him higher in the lineup here. I could see him getting more like 45 to 50 points. But it's all the intangibles that he brings. And people, like analytics people, I think analytically he looks pretty good too, actually. I think it was a good move. But the problem is it a good move for this team? From what I'm hearing, it's sounding like they got rid of, they're getting rid of a couple guys that were soft and, you know, not very competitive. They're looking, and they brought in a Nikita Zadorov. They're looking to get, obviously, tougher and more competitive. And they think that that alone is going to change the fortunes of this team. It probably will give more room and to Johnny Gaudreau and Sean Monahan, maybe. Make it so they can be a little more skilled than they were before. We have a problem with Matthew Tkachuk is going to be a free agent at the end of the year. There was talk of him going to St. Louis, but I don't know if that's going to be the case. I'm still just in question if this core is good enough to be a cup contender. And that's really what it comes down to. The move for Coleman will make it easier on Tkachuk because it seemed like he was fighting everybody's battles last year. And same as Tyler Pitlick. Those kind of guys will bring in... I'll take that a little bit off of Matthew Tkachuk and make him play a little offensive. But I'm going to have to see it, honestly. I just have a hard time believing that Losing Giordano with their captain, but you know, Christopher Tanev apparently is great in that role. I don't see a team that's complete here. I don't see a team that's complete. I think that's what I'm trying to say. Connor Zary's coming up. Jacob Pelche, maybe. You know, they've got a couple guys that will be able to probably pencil in the roster in the future. But in the near future, I don't see it. And I think they need a lot more. So we'll see what they do with the rest of the summer. But I thought they were going to do a complete rebuild here. Signing Coleman at $5 million a year, though, does not spell doing a rebuild. I think they're going to roll with these guys. And I'm not sure that's the best move. So I'm going to give them a C-, maybe even a D. And we'll see if they prove me wrong in that regard. But let's look at the depth chart before we take off here. Goudreau, Lindholm, Tkachuk, nothing wrong with that. Solid, especially if Goudreau is afforded the ability to go out and play a little more with open ice and less people bothering him because of taking on a guy like Coleman. Remember, Coleman's not a big, big guy, but he is a very yappy guy. He gets under people's skin, and he's a huge competitor. And I think that's a lot of the reason why they're picking him up is I think the level of compete on this team wasn't satisfactory for Sutter. So bringing in a Coleman will help out in that regard. Is it going to help out enough? I'm not sure. I love Mangiopane. I'm playing him up there. Coleman's not playing up there. It'll be Coleman, Backlund, and Pitlick. Mangiopane, Monahan, and Dubé. Although that's two small players playing on one line. I don't know. We'll see. But and that's the other thing. They're fairly small. You got Dubé at 5'11". Coleman's not big at 5'11", but he plays way bigger than that. Johnny Gaudreau at 5'9". Backlund's only 6 feet. You know, Lucic is 6'3 if he can catch people. I think they still got more work in this lineup. But right now, I'm going to give them a D-. Like, their defense, I don't like Zakita Zadorov. I think they paid way too much for him. What did they pay, by the way? Calgary. Oh, they don't even have it. I think he's making... Oh, yeah, that's right. He's a restricted free agent. So they haven't paid too much for him yet. We'll see how much they pay for him. Okay, Carolina Hurricanes. Crazy moves in Carolina. The Nedeljkovic trade. I'll start with the Nedeljkovic trade. He didn't want to sign for what you wanted to sign for. Honestly, I wasn't like super huge on Nedeljkovic bringing you to the promised land. So they traded him for Bernier and a third round pick to Detroit. And apparently it was the first offer they got. So they moved him like super fast. They didn't want to screw around, I guess. I don't know. I didn't know that, but when they got Bernier, I'm like, sign him up, man. He's been he's been doing awesome in Detroit. Just never tell. You can't tell because he's in Detroit. But I would have been all over it, and they didn't. So they end up going to get Frederick Anderson at $4.55 million. They must know that he's going to be okay. They must know that he's going to be healthy. Otherwise, this team is in trouble. I mean, Antti Raanta, if he can be healthy, can definitely play. The guy is a great goaltender. And playing in that, behind that defense that they have there, the system that they have there, both of them can look really, really good. I certainly like either one of them more than Mrazek if they're healthy. Raanta plays 3-4 games and he's injured. Over and over and over again. So we'll see what happens with that, but that doesn't look good. Anthony DeAngelo for 1 year, $1 million. All whatever he did in New York Rangers for the New York Rangers aside, this is a show me, you know, contract where I don't know what happened with the New York Rangers. I don't know what he said. Apparently, it wasn't a racist comment, according to him, and other people say that he's not a racist person. So. Did he get blacklisted for no reason? I don't know. But this at $1 million at one after losing Hamilton, he could be maybe not the most significant replacement because he's poor defensively, but he can replace the offense at $1 million. Could be fantastic. Ian Cole, 1 year, $2.9 million. Ian Cole's a good solid dude, man. He's a good solid defenseman. Probably a 5'6" guy. 2.9 is maybe on a little bit on the high side, but I get it. His character's through the roof. I like the guy. Josh Levo, he's tried and he's tried and he's tried. He's a big guy, but he's too soft to play in your bottom 5'6". I mean, he's okay. And Jordan Martinook at 1.8 was fantastic. He took a freaking team-friendly deal, all the heck there. So let's look at their cap space. And we got to remember, they got to sign Andrei Svechnikov. I have a feeling not taking Hamilton, the big reason for that is they want to sign this guy up. They want to sign him up right now. Something like 7 million for the next for 8 years. Give him a $56 million contract right now. He's almost putting a point a game up. I don't know if I would do that if I was Andrei Svechnikov, but if they're able to do it by the middle of that contract, it'll look fantastic. They got to sign possibly Niederreiter next year. I don't know. They gave him up for to Seattle, so maybe they just let him go, but. Vincent Trocheck. They got a lot of guys to sign right away. And this is not a cap team. So if you're wondering why they don't sign Hamilton to $8 million a year, they just can't afford that type of player. They don't. This is a small market team and they're just not able to afford it. So that's the reason why. Looking at their defense now, by the way, there was somebody missing here. Oh, it's D'Angelo. Slavin. Oh, we'll look at the depth chart in a second. Sorry. They have 50 million in cap space, but I'm not so sure that they have much more to spend. They are not ones to go to the cap. They seem to have an internal cap there. So I don't know if there's much more to spend for this roster, which is, kind of reason why they got to go almost by committee on a lot of areas. As it turns out, they lost Geeky in the expansion draft. Svechnikov, Aho, Teravainen. Nothing wrong with that. Still a few years for Aho. Like I said, try to get Svechnikov signed up to 7 or something like that for a long term, even 8, which would put them in. That's about all they got. And I think that's all they're going to do this year. So they're going to be flying with this lineup, probably. Niederreiter, Trocheck, Nietzsche. Nietzsche is going to be a beast next year again. 41 points in 53 games. Watch out. That's a fine top six. There's nothing wrong with that. Jordan Martinook, been, great utility guy, heart and soul guy. I don't blame him at 1.8 million signing him up. Jordan Staal, their leader, and Jesper Fast, good third line. And Lorenz, I don't think that's the one thing I think they will have to go get unless David Colton could be ready. He could be ready. They could try Cotton. I mean, not Colton, Cotton, or Jack Drury or Dominic Bock. Pretty good depth here to be able to bring up in their roster. Not to mention, let's not forget, you got Seth Jones chewing it up everywhere he goes. He could be in this roster, probably taking Niederreiter's spot next year. Noel Gundler, like they have done well drafting here. So they've got a lot of depth to fill up that center spot. I think they did well. My rating for for what they did, I got to give them C plus on paper because on paper they weren't. Oh yeah, I forgot about Bear Fogle for Bear. People are upset about Fogle for Bear, but Fogle, they have a lot of players coming up to replace Fogle, and but Brind'Amour was not playing them that much. Brind'Amour is a pretty smart guy. He was one of the best defensive players of all time. I think he knows when he sees what a player is, and I think they did well. I think you're gonna like Ethan Bear. Apparently, he had some conditioning issues though, so I hope they have a strong conditioning system there to be able to, for these guys to really encourage them to get to the gym because that I heard is like the biggest problem. But on skates. He could be your top four guy for sure. Put D'Angelo in. Ian Cole can play both sides. Gardner comes out of the lineup, and this is a pretty solid lineup. What time do we got here? Oh my gosh, I've gone long. Okay, that's what all I'm going to do for today. That's my full 42. I'm not even going to do the entrance. Hit the subscribe and the bell. Let's do a little Pirlo dance together. Have a great day. Okay, bye.